Right, from deficit cuts to jobs bills to the GOP candidates, we're talking all things Washington for the next hour because our guest host for the rest of the show is Senator Ron Johnson. It's great to have you, Senator.
Morning, Joe. Thanks for having me in.
You, we remember the last election. You ran against Russ Feingold, who had been there for a while, known as one of the most liberal members of the Senate, and you beat him in a liberal state in Wisconsin.
Well, I think Wisconsin really is, I would say, center-right. I think there are an awful lot of people that are fiscally conservative.
Oh, Ryan's from there.
Yeah, exactly.
You're next in Minnesota, though.
Correct. Yeah, we do have a sort of a liberal western side of the state there, but in general,
the one near Minnesota, near Frankenland.
No, in general, I think folks in Wisconsin are relatively fiscally conservative.
Yeah, you got Paul Ryan, obviously. Yeah, we heard from Richard Fisher that you actually know some stuff about business. Well, you're an accountant.
I'm accounting by training.
But you had a company.
I built a business for about 31 years, plastics manufacturing. Exported about 20% of our product. Our largest export country actually was China. So I know you can do that. And I take a look at China as a 1.2 billion person market opportunity. So I think that's the way we should look at it.
How old was you? You founded the company?
Yeah, back in 79.
Founded the company in 79. When you finished, how many employees did you have?
We're a pretty capital-intensive business, so we have one operator running about a $2.5 million piece of equipment, so we got about 120 employees.
In sales, what are they finally?
We keep that private, but we're I would consider ourselves a medium-sized business.
Medium-sized business, so the ones that we want to do well now because they do so much of the hiring. So
And a manufacturer. We actually make stuff.
You may know something about this kind of stuff. Unlike 80% of the members of Congress I saw over the weekend, no business degree, no business experience, no economics degree, yet they're passing all the laws.
Oh, no, I definitely have a different perspective than most people in Congress.
Are you struck by the lack of understanding of all things business in Washington?
I want to be kind, but again, I bring a different perspective. You know, having exported product, having manufactured product, understanding, let's face it, we're talking about very serious fiscal issues here, so I have that perspective of understanding numbers.
All right, we heard.
And I've got a lot of scary numbers, by the way.
You had a big buildup from Richard Fisher. You saw that in the green room. He said that the Fed, in his view, can't do everything. And that at this point, it's up to fiscal authorities to get their act together. When I push him on that, I try to say, what do you mean fiscal authorities get their act together? Pass the new jobs bill or get out of the way of
there
government? And he can't say it. He can't say it, but you can. You don't think we ought to be doing more. You think we ought to be getting out of the way.
Yeah, I mean, part of our problem in this country is we've become dependent on government. Like government can create jobs. It can't. Here's one scary number. The Small Business Administration conducted a study. What does it cost to comply with federal regulations in a year? $1.75 trillion. Now, I know that number's in somewhat dispute, but I want people to think about that. $1.75 trillion, that's 12% of our economy. It's larger than all but eight economies in the world. That's what we burden our manufacturing sector, our service sector, our job creators with. $1.75 trillion a year. So that is what we need to, we had to get that out of the way so that we can, businesses actually can feel
confident.
But we
want clean air. We want clean water. We don't want the financial system to collapse or near collapse.
No, I don't think, nobody is talking about unbridled capitalism. But when you're talking about saddling job creators with $1.75 trillion worth of costs, and you take a look at, now that I'm in government, you talk to these corporations, they have governmental affairs offices. You have compliance officers. In my business, I have a controller, and she's basically dealing with government regulations, all the forms, so she has to hire an assistant, still not enough. She has to hire another assistant, and then another assistant. And that gets repeated thousands of times across the country, and it's just that quiet opportunity cost of the effective and intrusiveness of government.
You saw the Harold Hamm piece. We talked about it in the journal, and it was to try and get a pipeline built from Canada down, and there were, I think, like eight agencies that had to sign off, eight government agencies that had to sign off. Do you want to have at it?
I
asking for specific.
I agree with you.
Regulations that are hurting.
I was going to agree with him, but I was also going to ask the transition from all. To cut all of that back, which may be ultimately the right answer, is also going to be quite painful. At a time when we're talking about jobs and job creation, by default, if you want to cut back government, which may be the right thing to do long term, the pain in between is going to be there simply because, as you said, if the $1.75 trillion number is real, that money is going to people who have jobs.
Let's first start by stopping Now, that's my piece of legislation is a regulation moratorium. Just stop. You know, take a pause until our economy can start recovering. But you know, you talk about cutting. Nobody's literally talking about cutting government. The only, in this debt ceiling agreement, the only thing you can consider a cut is in 30% of our budget, the discretionary part, $1.05 trillion we spent this year. Next year we'll spend $1.043 trillion. Then the next year $1.047 trillion. So that's $10 billion worth of cuts. That's what we spend in one day.
Right.
And of that $10 billion, we're borrowing about four. Otherwise, government continues to grow. So I'm pretty emphatic about making sure we're talking about we're reducing the rate of increase in government, and we have to do that if we're going to get this under control.
That's something the super committee has to do. What would you like to see the super committee do, and structurally, how would you like to see them do it? Some people say, ultimately, if you want to cut government, great, but you have to backload it, because otherwise, right now, given the where the economy
again, is, reduce the rate of growth in government. Okay. Listen, there have been so many studies going back to the Grace Commission. You know, that's I submitted a letter a proposal to the super committee that showed $1.4 trillion worth of cuts. Mm-hmm. Again, not reinventing the wheel. They're not my ideas. They're all these other studies. You know, Tom Coburn's come up with $9.5 trillion worth of cuts. Now, some of those things would be controversial. I tasked my staff with, let's come up with between $1.2 and $1.5 trillion of cuts that are already on the table, already been described by other people. That's what a businessman would do.
Right.
Now, let's not reinvent the wheel here. Just do it. Get that cutting out, get that reduction in the rate of increase out of the way, and move on to real things like tax reform, which I think is obvious that we need to do that.
Right.
But you know, we have got to, if you're going to restore confidence in the economy, we have got to come up with a credible plan for restraining the growth in government.
Right. I don't know if I have a copy of the New York Times here this morning, but there was one of the things.
Oh,
no.
Yeah, I wonder.
You know where I'm going with this. There is a story here this morning. In debt talks, all tax breaks are, I can't read that. I don't know if we can get that on camera there. But
that's a headline, Ron. Maybe there's going to be sacred cows among
different. There's going to be sacred cows, but here's the question.
Like in Texas, do they like oil and gas?
One of the things that you've talked about is trying to close some of the loopholes and also take down the tax rate. And yet, when you read a piece like that, and I thought it was actually quite fair and that it was bipartisan. It looked at Republicans and Democrats who do have their sacred cows. How we're ever going to actually get all these loopholes closed, because so many of these sacred cows exist.
Well, first of all, you have to define what's a true loophole. You know, things that are timing differences, you know, scaling back depreciation from 7 years to 5 years, that's a timing difference. That's not really a real loophole. So my sacred cow is, let's not do anything that's going to harm our ability to grow our economy. And that's my problem with tax increases is, you show me a tax increase that doesn't harm job growth, that doesn't harm economic growth, and that's maybe something I'd consider, but I just don't believe one exists.
But I'm looking here. John Kerry, who's a Democrat from Massachusetts, apparently doesn't want to eliminate a tax break for beer companies. Paul Ryan, who's a Republican, also, by the way, is supporting brewers with some kind of tax cut. I don't know if you.
No, wait a second. Is this going to hurt beer production?
Yeah, I mean,
I'd like to.
That's universally popular.
Yeah,
I would like to
raise my hand on it.
But I'm saying, it's just.
Hey, if they did it for wine coolers, you'd be all over this.
Andrew, here's the problem. You take a look at the $1.75 trillion of regulatory costs. You take a look at our corporate tax rate. When Japan lowers theirs, will be the highest in the world.
Zima.
This isn't rocket science. You've got to take a look. We're in a global economy. We don't have a choice of whether or not we're going to compete. We have to compete.
Right.
So you take a look at, what do you compete with? Your tax regimen and your regulatory regimen. And right now, we're not looking particularly attractive with other economies, with the growth economies. So you just have to get those things in line. You have to benchmark it. It's not that difficult.
Fair enough.
Faber, I said wine coolers. Carl, continue. Wine coolers.
Zima.
None of you drink wine coolers, but I've labeled
but
all of
it.
You.
You've done a very good job of labeling us all in one little basket.
I know it's the Upper East Side. Are you Upper East?
I'm
you're Upper West
Side.
Side.
All right. But coming up, will he or won't he? Reports are circulating, of course, this morning that New Jersey Governor Chris Christie might actually throw his hat into the ring to be the GOP presidential candidate in 2012. We're going to talk about Christie's chances and handicap the Republican field. That's coming up after the break. Squawk Box is coming right back.
I played professional basketball for 12 years. Today I own 165 Wendy's restaurants. And I get my financing from GE Capital. But I also get stuff that goes way beyond banking.
We not only lend people money, we help them save it.
GE engineers found ways to cut my energy use.
More efficient lighting helps juniors stay open later.
And serve more customers. So you're not just getting financial capital.
You're also getting human capital. Not just money, knowledge.
GE Capital. They're not just bankers.
We're builders.
And they've helped build my business.
The right environment for your company is a place where innovation comes naturally. Visit IDAIreland.com.
John Hancock Mutual Funds. Visit jhfunds.com.
Okay, yeah, maybe some of those little spinach quiches, those were fun.
Yeah, but not that other stuff, that was too salty last time.
And then I was thinking that I'd probably wear those little brown boots that I got last week. Did you see those?
Yeah, those were great, weren't they?
Oh yeah, those are so cute with the earrings.
No, really? No, she actually got escorted out. I know. Really?
When an investment lacks discipline, it's never this obvious. Introducing Investment Discipline ETFs from Russell.
Visit RussellETFs.com for a prospectus containing the investment objectives, risk, charges, expenses, and other information. Read and consider it carefully before investing.
Trading is on for the $1 Million Portfolio Challenge. This week, discover South Africa. Your chance to win a 3-night trip for two at one and only Cape Town, South Africa. Register and play now at milliondollar.cnbc.com.
Stamps.com is the best. I don't have to leave my desk and get up and go to the post office anymore.
There's nothing worse than going to the post office and waiting in line.
With Stamps.com, you can buy and print real U.S. postage for all your letters and packages, so you'll never have to go to the post office again.
They took a post office and sat it on my desk. It doesn't take up any room, I don't have to wait in line, and it never closes.
Now you can avoid trips to the post office. Go to Stamps.com and get a 4-week, no-risk trial.
It gives you the exact amount of postage you need, the instant you need it.
Saves me a good 4 or 5 hours a week.
It saves us so much time and money.
Postage meters are a lot more expensive.
Can you print only stamps? No.
First class?
Priority mail.
Certified.
International.
And the mailman picks it up.
I don't leave the shop anymore.
Now it's all under my control. And I like that.
Learn more at stamps.com/TV and get a 4-week trial, plus $100 in extras, including a scale and free postage to use during your trial. Go to stamps.com/TV and never go to the post office again.
Back. You know, on Friday, I had the opportunity to talk to Warren Buffett about President Obama's jobs plan and the so-called Buffett tax. Take a look.
I don't know what their program will be. My program would be on the very high incomes that are taxed very low, not just high incomes. Some guy can make a $50 million a year playing baseball. His taxes won't change. Make $50 million a year appearing on television. His income won't change. But if they make a lot of money and they pay a very low tax rate, like me, it would be changed by a minimum tax that would only bring them up to what the other people pay.
You know, I wanted to play that, Joe, because a lot of people, including a lot of the Republican websites and others, said that he was effectively saying that he was not on board with the Buffett rule that Obama's presented. I'm not sure that's what I would take away from that. What I thought was most interesting is he's effectively saying that he only wants to really tax the ultra wealthy. And the question is, are the ultra wealthy just $1 million and is $1 million over? What's he want to do with people over $10 million? He talked about 50,000 people, and I was trying to look that up over the weekend to figure out how many people, you know, what kind of money do you have to be making to really be impacted by this?
I try to figure out how to do it, because it is true that the very wealthy people don't have a lot of ordinary income.
This is really a carried interest story.
They have capital gains and dividends, but then again, low capital gains taxes. Bill Clinton, while going up on the marginal rates, went down on capital gains, and you know, you can argue why the 90s.
And we got more revenue.
And we got more revenue. So I'd like, if you were to present to Warren, and I love him and he comes on the show and we're friends, but if you were to present to him a wealth tax where you just say, all right, you got over $50 million net worth, 10%, give it to us. We want it. Right? Because you haven't been paying it in income. You haven't been paying it in capital gains. We want 10% of your $50
billion. Right. It's basically an AMT.
I think he'd go, for $5 billion, if you said, I just want 10% of a wealth tax, do you think he'd be okay with that?
I don't know if he'd be okay with that. But
I don't either.
This is the equivalent of an AMT. That's what it really is. Think about an AMT on ultra wealthy people. That's
AMT,
what this is.
Right.
By the way, we don't have the clip now, but the other thing that he said, he didn't really want to answer the question. I'd asked him about the $250,000, which we've talked about. And I wasn't sure that he was on board with that. He didn't say he wasn't, but he didn't answer the question either. So it's worth considering.
That's the most annoying thing, is the meat of what President Obama is talking about, millionaires and billionaires. You're really talking about 250 to a million. And that's 90% right. of the filers. Are
and what Buffett's saying is,
and a million.
Buffett's really
but
going after
no,
people a million and over.
Right,
that's actually his big
and
point.
And if you tax them at 100%, it's like a drop in the bucket for what we need
but
to
I
do.
But I think one of the things that he said that was and that's important is he said, you know, even if it doesn't raise all of this money, right, it may be a drop in the bucket. But I think he's going at this same sense of fairness. And I think there's something to be said about that. I know we've disagreed on this broadcast about that.
But then what we disagree about is it fair that the top 10% pay 70% of the federal income tax? Is that the fairness that you're talking about? Does that seem fair to you?
Well, he would argue that if you look at the ultra-wealthy over the past decade, that the ultra-wealthy have become even wealthier.
You know what
irritated
me? I saw a sign from the protesters that said, live simply so that others can simply live. And that's the whole notion that I've even heard from the president about a zero-sum game, that people that create wealth, someone that creates a company, that you're taking it out of the mouths of children that are poor, that there's somehow only a finite amount of money out there that you need to divvy up among people. And that's not true. It's not a zero-sum game. You create wealth.
The problem with the 250 and over, again, those are small businesses that report through subchapter S or LLCs. Right. That was my business. And so when you increase their tax, I mean, that's money that they can't put into increased wages, 401ks, health benefits. No, that's just true. Investment into plant and equipment. I mean, that right. hurts. And the other thing, even in the millionaires, you increase their tax. Well, an awful lot of the reason their taxes are low is because they're buying what? U.S. Treasuries. They're tax-free, so increase their tax. That means the yield on U.S. Treasuries, and it's going to cost us more.
We'll have Warren on, and you can debate the subject. We've got another political story to talk about this morning, and the question of the morning, will he run? You know who I'm talking about. Reports circulating in the last few days that New Jersey Governor Chris Christie is rethinking his decision to stay out of the 2012 presidential race. What would a Christie candidacy mean for the GOP field, and does he have a real shot at the White House? That's the question of the morning. Joining us now, former New York Congresswoman Susan Molinari and Steve Edwinoff, former chairman, campaign manager, rather, to Dick Gephardt and John Kerry. Thank you guys for joining us. So let's just have at it straight up. Susan, does he run?
You know, if I had to guess today, I would say and certainly hope that he does run. I've not spoken to the campaign, although I have a lot of friends who work for the governor. But the fact that he has apparently taken a real serious turn to discuss this, I think, you know, proves that maybe he will. Look, in the past he said he wasn't ready, and I think maybe he's looking at the fact now that this president looks eminently beatable, so it's not waiting 4 years, it's probably waiting 8 years to run for president of the United States, and I think he'd be an amazing candidate, and I sure hope he does run.
Steve, is it too late, though? I mean, people have talked about sort of what it takes, where we are in the process, how much money needs to be raised before you get to New Hampshire, before you get to Iowa. Is it doable physically?
I think it's too late. I think, you know, we're now looking at the calendars potentially moving up. It's really hard to get elected president, and it's even harder to run for president. And I think he has got the amount of money he's got to raise, the time he's got to spend in these states. I think it's very difficult to do. It's a tough thing to do. I'd be surprised if he said yes.
Ron, weigh in on this. You've lived it. Is it doable at this point in the ballgame?
Well, I jumped in the race May 17th of the election year. So, you know, certainly with media nowadays, you know, I think money is less important because you have all the social media, you have all kinds of different ways to get information out. But, you know, I think the appeal of Chris Christie is the fact that he speaks forthrightly, honestly. You know, our country does hunger for leadership. Mm-hmm. You know, people are actually willing to be elected and then define the problem and then make the hard decisions, take the tough votes to solve the problems. And that's the appeal of Chris Christie.
Right. Susan, I know you're a big fan. My question then becomes, you know, you put him up against a Mitt Romney, mm-hmm. and you put him up against a Perry. Let's push Perry out and just okay. say it becomes a Christie-Romney decision. Christie seems very attractive now. Mm-hmm. As the campaign wears on, what would you worry about most?
Well, you know, the truth is that's what I think is the beauty of Chris Christie. I don't know that there's all that much to worry about. I mean, obviously, there's things that we don't know about a person, but running for the state of New Jersey as governor, he has taken on a very high profile. Some of the things that we don't know about him are great. His record as a U.S. attorney, you know, is brilliant in terms of taking on the mob, taking on corrupt politicians. He's capped property taxes. He's reined in pensions in New Jersey. He's balanced a budget. There's a lot of appeal to the senator's point is what people see in him, and that is just this straight-talking but passionate individual. I think the more we learn about Chris Christie, the more people are going to actually be attracted to him. And I think to the senator's point, what he shows is an absolute straight-talking position of leadership, and I think that's what this country wants. They want somebody who's going to stand up and advocate for them and connect with them, and he has that sort of New Jersey style of connecting with people out there who are hurting right now.
Steve, you know, when I think about this, the one thing I was watching a Republican strategist over the weekend suggest that he has a better chance of winning the presidency than he does his reelection of his governorship in New Jersey. Only because that whatever goes on in New Jersey next is going to get ugly. Do you think if he doesn't jump in now, he will still have a chance in 2016?
Yeah, because I think Barack Obama is going to get reelected, and if I was a Republican, I would wait till 2016 when there's an open field. But he's going to have a tough time in New Jersey. He's a moderate in a state, and he's going to be running in a Republican primary that is not, the moderates are not welcome in. The problem he has right now is that extremists in the Republican Party would like a new candidate because they're not happy with Mitt Romney. But once he gets in, people are going to look at his positions on things like immigration in the Republican Party, and I don't think they're going to like Chris Christie as much as they do right now.
Fair enough. Susan, Steve, we're going to leave it right there. Appreciate it very, very much.
Thank you.
All right, coming
up, be here.
More today's top stories. First, though, it is the beginning of the quarter, first trading day. We're going to head to Chicago to see what's moving in the futures bit of gold.
All the different ways we affect people. Imagine what our brands could do for your brand. We're Gannett, and we'll keep it all within reach.
In America, we believe in a future that is better than today. Since 1894, Ameriprise Financial has been working hard for their clients' futures, never taking a bailout. Helping generations achieve dreams, buy homes, put their kids through college, retire how they want to. Ameriprise. The strength of America's largest financial planning company. The heart of 10,000 advisors working with you. One-to-one. Together. For your future.
Still don't know what I was waiting for. And my time was running wild. In the streets and every time I thought I got it made, it seemed the taste was not so sweet.
Quiet, powerful. BMW Advanced Diesel.
Get a $3,500 eco credit and BMW navigation at no extra cost.
Look, every day we're using more and more energy.
The world needs more energy.
Where's it going to come from?
That's why right here in Australia, Chevron is building one of the biggest natural gas projects in the world. Enough power for a city the size of Singapore for 50 years.
What's it going to do to the planet?
Natural gas is the cleanest conventional fuel there is.
We've got to be smart about this.
It's a smart way to go.
Japanese markets rocked by...
With the Nikkei down, it looks like there's a little fear in the market. I suspect that we're going to have a hugely volatile day. When we look at CNBC, we can see instantly how the market is going to react.
It's very crazy day.
The market can run you right over. I use the CNBC mobile app to check the markets around the world. The markets never stop. Only when I'm sleeping am I not connected. That's it. I am American business. I watch CNBC.
The markets are coming off the worst three-month period since the financial crisis. Traders are ready to start a new quarter. We're going to head down to the futures pits in Chicago to find out what we can expect from the first trading day of the fourth quarter. And then former Arkansas Senator Blanche Lincoln. She doesn't like regulations now, and she's very outspoken about it. Politics, jobs, and taxes. Squawk Box will be right back.
Your hard work has paid off.
and you want to pass along as much as possible to future generations. At Northern Trust, we know what works and what doesn't. As one of the nation's largest wealth managers, we can help you manage the complexities of transferring wealth, seeking to minimize taxes while helping maximize what's passed along. Because you just never know how big those future generations might be. Expertise matters. Find it at Northern Trust.
You can experiment with your investments. Choose the stocks you like one by one, or select sector spider ETFs and add the diversification of an entire sector of the S&P 500, like healthcare. With liquidity, all-day tradability, and transparency. Ready to add diversification to your equity investments? Before investing, consider the fund's investment objectives, risks, charges, and expenses. Go to sectorspiders.com for prospectus containing this information. Read carefully. Visit us at sectorspiders.com.
At Passages Malibu, we treat and heal the underlying causes of addiction so you can live a healthy, addiction-free life. This is not a 12-step program. This works. I should know. I was an addict for 10 years. Now I'm not.
Call 888-924-CURE and end your addiction now.
Today, fourth quarter outlook. Where have all the hedge funds gone? Karen has the big money moves. Then, with European worries looming, is First Energy a bright light in a dark market? Get fast, go mad. CNBC Today, 5 Eastern.
Is your computer running slowly? Thinking about buying a new one? Don't waste your money. Your computer could be infected with spyware, malware, viruses, or you could be experiencing registry errors, spam, and pop-ups. With new technology, you no longer need a technician to come to your home or drop your computer at some store. Get a free diagnosis at MaxMySpeed.com and find out in minutes what's slowing down your computer.
They were able to diagnose it and solve our problem. It's at least 100% to 150% quicker than before.
My computer runs twice as fast.
The computer has run so much quicker. It's safer, it's faster, it's more secure.
My computer is 100% faster than it was prior. All I can say is I'm a raving fan. This is unbelievable.
Go to MaxMySpeed.com right now for your free diagnosis and find out in minutes what's slowing down your computer. That's MaxMySpeed.com for your free diagnosis.
Welcome back to Squawk Box. We're checking the markets this morning with some red arrows still across the board. It's gotten actually a little bit worse recently.
60 again, Andy.
Back up to 60 if the market opened now with Dow Jones. S&P 500 about 7 points down, and NASDAQ would be off about 18 points. Another story we've been looking at this morning, take a look at shares of Morgan Stanley. You know, on Friday there was a lot of speculation about what was going on with their exposure to the French banks. You saw some of the CDS spreads really widen out there. I just wanted to point out a couple things. One is the CDS is so thinly traded these days, I'm not sure how much we should take away from it the same way that we did in the fall of 2008 when there was a lot of anxiousness. But more importantly, a report out from Wells Fargo this morning saying, quote, Morgan Stanley's French exposure appears to be quite manageable. It's slightly more than $1 billion before hedges and collateral. It's suggesting that its total exposure is $2.4 billion before hedging benefits and $1.4 billion net of hedges. It's also just suggesting that the market's newest concern, derivatives, is overblown in our view. They're still saying they prefer J.P. Morgan and PNC for defense and Goldman Sachs as a more cyclical play, but that they're not nearly as worried about Morgan Stanley as some of the markets seem to be. So maybe that'll calm the markets a little bit. I actually did some reporting on this over the weekend, Joe, and I got to tell you, I didn't feel as nervous as I think some of the people in the markets did Friday afternoon. And you know I'm always nervous now. I know. I think that Morgan Stanley has, I don't want to say they have their act completely together, but I don't think it's nearly as bad as some of the CDS spreads would suggest. Excuse me?
What was the low in 08 when they brought in the investment from, what was it, Mitsubishi or something?
Mitsubishi, which, by the way, people forget about that. Mitsubishi has a 25% stake in this company, $10 billion. So when you talk about...
Well, they're not...
They're
underwater still, aren't they?
Yeah, but when you talk about liquidity and their access to capital, right. A, they have access to the Fed, but B, Mitsubishi has a huge amount of deposits. And even if you just look at their numbers, sort of 2008, 2007 versus now, it's a totally different story in terms of their...
Under seven,
right?
Under seven, unbelievable. 2000, back in October of 08.
So anyway, joining us now from the CME, Mr. Santelli is with us. Mr. Santelli, what are you looking at this morning, my friend?
Well, looking at a world where equities are on the soft side, interest rates are moving lower. Countries like the UK have AAA reaffirmed ratings, and Greece is debating, you know, whether they can actually deliver on promises that we know they can't deliver on. So really not much has changed. Another beginning of a week. This week doesn't have auctions. It'll have the twist. We're going to be doing Operation Twist on Monday as we underscore all the novelties of government trying to make a difference.
You know, Rick, we had Fisher on it. I don't know if your ears are burning. I did reference you a couple of times. I think he's more with you than against you on a lot of things. I was trying to figure out the dual mandate and contrasting our dual mandate with a single mandate in the ECB. And my point was I didn't think the ECB did much better with a single mandate. You would probably disagree because you thought that maybe Trichet should have been worried about inflation and overheating, when now it looks like it was, you know, maybe they should have been facing reality with how slow things were. But you didn't get to hear any of that discussion, I guess.
No, I didn't, Joe. Sorry, I was commuting in, but I will say this. Implicit in your words are that there's going to be an easing. They haven't eased yet. That's the West telling them to ease. That's our glasses being put on everybody as, you know, narcissistic central bankers telling Jean-Claude Trichet what to do. I'm not saying I agree with everything that the ECB does, but their inflation rates at three-year highs, they have a single pillar, and that lower interest rates haven't done anything in this country as to what it was dictated to do. Obviously, hey, you know, Treasury owes a lot of money, better keep those rates down. I get that part of it, but I think that the ECB will probably not cut rates. I don't think their overnight rates too high. Maybe they have a couple of savers that can actually see the sky when they wake up in the morning.
What happened to the 30-year today, Rick?
Well, you know, 30-year, they're going to do the twist. They're going to purchase. There has been movement there. You know, for the first time, we now see the spread between a 10-year and a 30-year under 100 basis points. That was in the mid-120s, close to 130 before Operation Twist. So, of course, they're hooking the last part of the yield curve to conform to the notion that, you know, interest rates can't possibly go up. It will delay the recovery that hasn't really begun. I'm not sure I get the logic.
All right,
there it is. Rick, thanks so much. Appreciate it.
All right, we're going to reach across the aisle this morning to talk jobs and the economy. Former Senator Blanche Lincoln joins us now, along with our guest host, Senator Ron Johnson. Senator, it's good to have you back on the show this morning.
Glad to be with you.
Appreciate it. What do you think we need to do at this point? What would you like to see Congress do? Do more on the fiscal side of things vis-a-vis the president's jobs bill, or do less in terms of regulation?
Well, obviously regulations are a great way for us to jumpstart creating these jobs. I've been working with the National Federation of Independent Businesses to really get the message out there. I mean, you've got small businesses across this country. 50% of our GDP, 60% of our private sector jobs are small businesses, and two-thirds of the net new jobs created every year are created by small businesses. One of the best ways we can help those small businesses create jobs and bolster the economy is to lessen the lack of predictability they have in terms of regulation. There's tremendous regulation, over 4,200 new regulations out there that are pending. I mean, this is an unpredictability that does not allow them to use their own resources, reinvest in themselves, because they just don't know what's out there. So it's a great way to create jobs, and it doesn't cost money.
There's clean air, there's clean water. We talked about this. We look at the regulations that are in Dodd-Frank or Obamacare. Weren't you a key vote in Obamacare, Senator? And now, I mean, would you go back and change that vote because of all the regulations that are implicit in Obamacare by 2014?
No, I wouldn't change the vote. I think health care has been an issue for us for a long time. I think the biggest problem that we have with our economy right now is everyone wants to get to the finish line, but no one wants to start the process. That bill wasn't perfect. I've never voted for a bill that's perfect, and I know Senator Johnson's going to find the same thing, that there's bills out there that are going to help start the process and get us down the road. Are there things in health care that we need to change? Absolutely. I was the only Democrat and the first Democrat to sign on as a co-sponsor of Senator Johan's amendment on the 1099 reporting. You know, there's things that we've got to do, but you've got American families out there, working families, small businesses that really want to get about the business of what they do, and that's create jobs, help bolster the economy. And many of them are stymied by the fact that they have no idea where these regulations are going, what it's going to cost them, how is it going to hamstring them in a way that they're not going to be able to do what they do. So what do? They don't use their own resources. They don't reinvest in themselves. So, you know, I think that there's no doubt that everybody wants clean air. They want clean water. And that is not the purpose of the campaign we have. We've doubled our numbers since August. We've got over 800 small businesses. We want the voices of small businesses to be heard across this country so that they can talk about the unreasonable regulations that exist and the lack of predictability that they have with all of these pending regulations that really preclude them from doing what they do best, and that's create jobs.
So, Senator Lincoln, this is Senator Johnson. Nice to meet you over the television here.
Yes, it is. Congratulations to you.
Going back to the health care issue, you know, one of the things that I've been grappling with is what's going to be the true cost of Obamacare. And I just kind of want to know, when you were voting for that, the CBO estimated that about 3.6 million people would lose their employer-sponsored care. Now we have surveys saying anywhere from 30 to 50% of employers plan on dumping coverage very soon after the law takes effect. I mean, was that discussed back then when people were voting on that in terms of being $93 billion, possibly costing $500 billion to $1 trillion a year?
You know, there was talk about an awful lot of savings as well. Yes, there's talk about cost. It's spread over a 10, 15-year period. There are things that have to be implemented in 2012 and 2013, 2014. The point is where are you going to start? We saw people losing their health insurance before the health care bill happened. We also saw the increased cost and the continuing increased cost of health care. I'm not saying it's a perfect bill, but what I'm saying is if people don't start the process, you know, you're never going to get where you need to be, and that is bringing down the cost of health care, making sure that more individuals are getting the kind of care, incentivizing businesses and industries to be able to incentivize their workers. The idea that you can now encourage workers with increased benefits or lowering their cost of premiums and deductibles. If they're getting well care, if they're getting their immunizations, if they're exercising, if they're keeping their weight down, if they're doing smoking cessation. I mean, all of these moves in the right direction. We've got to make sure that we are a healthier bunch of people in this great country, and we've got to give industries a great incentive to do a lot of that.
But in your work with smaller businesses, are you hearing that they are going to be dropping coverage like those surveys from McKenzie and Price Waterhouse are indicating?
Actually, what I think you're finding when you really talk to small businesses, that they know that if they're 50 or below, they're pretty much exempt from everything. So they're going to have an ability to go into the networks and the pools. What we designed, and Olympia Snow and I worked hard on it over the past 10 years, was to create a plan or at least a template like what we had as federal employees, like you have right now. You can go in there and choose from multiple plans, and that's because you're pooled with all the other 8 million federal employees across the country. When those small businesses can put their businesses and their employees into those pools, they'll have access to greater plans, more robust plans, not to mention different plans, and they'll be able to keep down that cost because they're pooled with millions and millions of other employees from small businesses across the country.
Senator, do you think that the Obama administration is the right one to go forward in 2012? If you were solely worried about what you're trying to do here with regulations, would you support a Republican candidate instead of
President Obama because of the stance that his administration has on regulations.
Well, I mean, there's a lot of Republican candidates out there, and who knows who the nominee is going to be. But no, I would support President Obama.
Because it seems to be antithetical to your deal on regulation, because a lot of the regulations are controlled by the agencies, which are controlled by the executive branch. And, you know, we hear it every day, EPA, NLRB. OSHA again and again and again, and that's one of the main complaints about this administration. It just seems hypocritical to continue to back this administration when you're trying to help small businesses with regulation.
There's been the same criticism of every administration and every one of these agencies. You know, it's not just this administration. These agencies are full of bureaucrats that have been there for a long time.
Yeah.
I think that President Obama has taken some good steps. I'd like to see him continuing to move in that direction, in pulling back the ozone regulation. Mm. You know, some of the different things he's done there. These are some of the same ones that, you know, we saw come from President Bush and President Clinton. Obviously, President Clinton made the same effort in terms of putting out an executive order. We've got to make sure that we hold them to the line.
Yeah.
I think that's important.
Well, I appreciate you responding to that, and I know you got to walk the line, and we appreciate what you're trying to do for small business.
Be honest with you, walking the line means standing up for what's right and standing up for small businesses and making sure that we're looking
where the jobs are. I mean,
That's exactly right.
Whenever you see something that is counterproductive for that, I scratch my head and wonder what they're thinking. But anyway, we appreciate your time today, Senator. Thank you.
You bet. Thank you.
Coming up, we're going to head down to the New York Stock Exchange for the latest buzz from Wall Street. And then tomorrow, former Senator Evan Bayh of Indiana, he's going to be our guest host. We're going to talk jobs, politics, and taxes. Squawk Box is coming back right after the break.
On CNBC, every minute counts.
We are investing at Berkshire a record $7 billion in plant and equipment this year. 90%+ is in the United States.
We got some big breaking news right now. Kodak shares have been halted. Kodak has hired Jones Day, a major corporate law firm, to advise about a possible restructuring. The stock is down more than 60% right now.
People look at a stock and they think, hey, $2, how much can I lose? 100%!
CNBC. Capitalize on it.
You do not need to spend $1,000 per month for timely market information. You can get it all for $69 plus vendor associated fees when applicable from Interactive Brokers. And you do not have to have a brokerage account with us to subscribe. Organize and analyze timely data or news on the IB information system. Interactive Brokers, stocks, options, futures, Forex, bonds, worldwide, from one account.
What's in the mail? Well, it just might surprise you. Because this is how people and business connect. Feeling safe and secure that important letters and information don't get lost in thin air or disappear with a click, but are delivered from person to person. And sometimes, even face to face.
Have a great day.
You too. For some of the best ways to connect and protect, it's all in the mail. Learn more at usps.com/mail.
At ADT, we get financing from GE Capital, but they also go beyond banking. We installed a GE fleet monitoring system. It tracks every vehicle in their fleet. It cuts fuel use and enhances customer service. It's pretty amazing when people who loan you money also show you how to save it. Not just money, knowledge. It's so much information. It's like I'm right there in every van in the entire fleet. Good day overall? Yeah. Doing good? Come on in. Let's go. Wow, this is fantastic. GE Capital, they're not just bankers. We're builders. They help build our business.
Have you dreamed of exploring the world? Paris, Budapest, St. Petersburg, Beijing. Experience dramatic landscapes and rich history in the easiest way possible on board the modern vessels of Viking River Cruises. You'll spend less time getting there and more time being there. Viking River Cruises, exploring the world in comfort.
We realized we had the opportunity to inspire and create the next generation of minority-owned businesses. AP Capital Partners is a middle-market private equity firm One of our companies is a heat treater, so natural gas prices have a direct impact on our bottom line. I watch CNBC every day, checking up on the debt and the equity market because it affects our ability to help finance and or acquire new businesses.
I am American business. I watch CNBC.
It is the first day of the fourth quarter. Let's get down to the New York Stock Exchange for a look at what traders will be watching today, and the entire crew is there.
All at the same time.
Carl, Melissa, and Jim join us
now.
Yeah,
you guys should try it.
Oh, man.
Thanks, Carl.
No,
appreciate
I'm kidding.
That.
Becky, how long until Becky gets back, Joe? Any idea?
I don't know. I was alerted that the, you know what, I don't even think you're allowed to talk about pregnancy or a child leave. I think you can get like thrown in HR for that. So, but I think it might be longer than I thought. I think she can do 8 weeks if she wants, maybe, right? Yeah.
Well, we miss her. I know she's having a blast.
Wouldn't you with a beautiful baby boy? I mean, yes. I don't know. I would, as much fun as Andrew and I are, Yeah, I guess it's Andrew and I. Oh, yeah, okay.
There's actually less crying at her house than there is on that set.
Yeah, exactly.
Right.
That's funny. And less diaper changing, too. Just say it, Carl. That's funny. Ha, ha, ha.
Joe, you set it up nicely, though. First day of the quarter, we're going to talk about the game plan, according to Jim.
Right.
And we'll ask whether some of these things, like transports, worst day on Friday in almost 3 years, mean anything.
What? And then Arch Cole doing the classic after the close pre-announcement. I mean, violating all the rules. End of quarter. End of Friday, boom, just terrible. I want to ask Andrew, when you did reporting on Morgan Stanley this weekend, I know I did similar reporting last week. Why do you think that the reporting this time just doesn't seem to matter to what would normally be a great opportunity?
Right. Well, I think what's happened is everybody's focused on the CDS spreads. And I think the difference between the CDS spreads today, even though they're blown out, compared to what CDS spreads were like back in, let's say, the fall of 2008, is that they're so thinly traded today on a relative basis then that I'm not sure we can take away too much from that. I also think when you think about how much money they have, I'm looking, they have about $182 billion in liquidity. They have much more deposits than they ever had before. So I think we're just, it's an apples to orange situation. However, I always worry about these things becoming self-fulfilling prophecies simply because we talk about them.
And I mean, the question is, in terms of exposure, what's the gross number? What's the net number?
Right.
If they have exposure, how much are they hedged through derivatives, et cetera? And there was an interesting piece, I think it was in the Times today, Andrew, saying essentially, you know, even if you know the gross number and you know the net number, that can change at any second because you can all of a sudden lose the collateral or whatnot, and then you have a bigger gross number than you thought.
I'll tell you, and I'm just taking away from voices. I remember the fall of 2008. I remember talking to people at Morgan Stanley, and even when you could feel how worried they were. Maybe everyone's just putting on a front and a good face as they have to, but this just feels different to me.
Well, that was also one of the great chapters in the book, Andrew, because it was pretty clear that people got angry, even at you, I thought, just to even be reporting on it.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. So,
interesting moment.
All right. Thanks, guys. We'll see you 11 minutes.
11 minutes to go.
It's good to have you back.
Right. Coming up, we're going to have more from our guest host, Senator Ron Johnson. And check this out. The Detroit Lions victorious on the football field yesterday. But this is a great segue, isn't it? Could Disney's Lions win the box office? Very clever to our writers in the control room. Find out next. Squawk Box coming back right after this.
Intercontinental Exchange. Futures exchanges, OTC markets and clearinghouses. ICE, global markets in clear view.
Look, every day we're using more and more energy.
The world needs more energy.
Where's it going to come from?
That's why right here in Australia, Chevron is building one of the biggest natural gas projects in the world. Enough power for a city the size of Singapore for 50 years.
What's it going to do to the planet?
Natural gas is the cleanest conventional fuel there is.
We've got to be smart about this.
It's a smart way to go.
Revolutionary technology. Driven by precision. Technicians as advanced as the vehicles they service. And now get all of this expertise at a price that may surprise you. Like Durastop ceramic brake pads installed for only $74.95 or less per axle after mail-in rebate.
Not just service, certified service. Only at your Chevrolet, Buick, GMC, and Cadillac dealer.
Yesterday doesn't win. Big doesn't win. Titles and corner offices don't win. What wins? Original wins. Fresh wins. Smart wins. The world's most dynamic companies know what wins in business today. Maybe that's why so many choose to work with us. We're Grant Thornton, Audit Tax Advisory.
Play now, CNBC's fantasy trading competition, the Million Dollar Portfolio Challenge. Grand prize, $1 million. Register now at milliondollar.cnbc.com.
Most of you remember me as the $6 million man. Now I'm here to introduce the Lee Majors Bionic Rechargeable Hearing Aid. This amazing aid hides discreetly in your ear. But unlike some other battery-powered units, my bionic ear is rechargeable. It can easily adjust the amplification level to suit your individual needs. It even lets you hear phone conversations without additional amplification. You can comfortably hear loud sounds while enjoying the subtle sounds of nature. Here's how to get my bionic rechargeable hearing aid.
Call now and the Lee Majors patented rechargeable hearing aid can be yours to try for 30 days for just $14.95. You'll receive the hearing aid rechargeable case. Just place and close. It's that easy. Four ear caps for comfort fit, the AC adapter, a custom cleaning brush, plus a carrying case and two AAA batteries for convenient use when traveling. This is a limited trial offer for only $14.95. Order now and try it all for 30 days.
Visit HearingAidTV.com or call now to find out more. Live operators are standing by.
Welcome back to Squawk Box. The futures right now, we've got red arrows. It's actually gotten worse since we began the broadcast. The Dow Jones, if we open today, right now, that is, it would be off about 70 points. The S&P 500 off about 7 points. The NASDAQ off about 20 points. So not a great way to start the week. But after 2 weeks at the top of the box office, The Lion King 3D falling to third place. The family film Dolphin Tale took the top spot, beating out the movie I actually haven't seen yet but want to see, Moneyball, and four newcomers. You've seen Moneyball or you haven't yet?
No, but I met the...
Who'd you meet?
The little actress that plays Brad Pitt's daughter.
Very cool.
Karis Dorsey, and she's a wonderful, beautiful little girl.
Dolphin Tale's weekend take, a nice $14.2 million in U.S. and Canadian theaters.
She's the star of the episode in The Haunting Hour.
Got it.
That would be in January, February.
Blake, your daughter, is in it.
Barely. Yeah, and Penelope.
And Penelope's in it, too.
And I actually had a bus driver's outfit on, but I think I'm going to be...
You think you'd be cut?
I was holding my stomach, and in that role, I let it out.
To be the bus driver.
Yes, loading the luggage and everything, and I was glad I had it. But that's acting. To actually have a
little... Did you do some method acting classes?
I did. I was, you know, scratching and just being just bus driver like, you know, didn't... Not that they scratch, but yeah. Anyway, coming up, more from our guest host, Senator Ron Johnson. Squawk Box coming right back.
Wow.
Come on. This is the Montrose Pet Hospital, Montrose, California. In here, anarchy meets order. Working with AT&T, doctors set up a broadband solution to handle data and a mobility app to stay connected with their business so they can run the office even when they're not in the office. It's a network of possibilities, helping you do what you do even better. Call AT&T and see what we can do for your business.
One line helps communities turn plans into reality. Helps shippers forge a path to prosperity. Helps workers get back to work. One line is an engine for the economy and the future. Norfolk Southern. One line, infinite possibilities.
So if I didn't know better, I'd say you're having some sort of big tire sale.
Yes, we are.
Yeah. How many tires does Ford buy every year?
Over 3 million.
You say you could beat any advertised price on tires?
Correct.
Anywhere?
Yes.
Like this price?
Yes.
Seriously?
Yes.
What about this one?
I'll beat it.
This one?
Yes, we will.
All right. I only have one more question for you.
Yes.
This one?
Yes.
Get a $100 rebate when you buy four tires. $100 only at your Ford dealer.
3 million tires, 11 major brands. Fiona's kind of nice. I don't know why you're not here.
Medicare.
It doesn't cover everything, and what it doesn't cover can cost you some money. That's why you should consider an AARP Medicare Supplement Insurance Plan insured by United Healthcare Insurance Company. All Medicare Supplement Insurance Plans can help pay some of what Medicare doesn't, so you could save thousands of dollars in out-of-pocket expenses. Call now for this free information kit and Medicare guide. If you're turning 65 or you're already on Medicare, you should know about this card. It's the only one of its kind endorsed by AARP. See if it's right for you. All Medicare supplement plans let you keep your own doctor or hospital that accepts Medicare. There are no networks and no referrals needed. Help protect yourself from some of what Medicare doesn't pay and save up to thousands of dollars in potential out-of-pocket expenses with an AARP Medicare Supplement Insurance Plan insured by United Healthcare Insurance Company. Call this toll-free number on your screen now for this free information kit, including this Medicare guide and customized rate quote.
Tonight, unprecedented access to the plane that could change the way you fly. Corporate giving from the heart or just getting ahead? A minister with a calling to a lucrative life of crime. Tonight, starting 8 Eastern on CNBC.
Our guest host has been Senator Ron Johnson. Latest I heard was that the jobs bill can't get through the Senate, democratically controlled Senate.
Well, that's because there's Democratic senators that won't support it, so no.
So it's not going to get through the Senate. So
I don't believe it'll even be brought up.
Last week he said, I sent it to you 3 weeks ago, I want it back. I want you to send it to me, let's get it done. So that's more, he knows it's not coming back?
No, I mean, it's really just a political document. He's playing class warfare, he's talking about taxing the rich. And again, the question I ask anybody when somebody proposing a tax increase is, how many jobs will that tax increase create? How's that going to grow our economy?
How about these trade bills? They're going to going to happen?
I believe so, yeah.
Boehner's going to bring them right up.
Yeah. And they finally got their TAA, so they'll...
The retraining, it less or more? That was a side show.
I can't remember the exact number, but we have like 80 or 90 different training programs in the federal government.
Done a study on whether any of them work.
Well, they're beginning to. That's, Senator Tom Coburn. Tom Coburn had the GAO take a look at duplication in government and identified $150 to $250 billion a year in duplicated programs. There's where you start in terms of looking at limiting the growth in government.
You got anything?
I'll tell you where I want to go with this conversation and understand what you think about payroll tax holidays and that portion of the jobs program. Whether you think there's something that does have to happen between now and the election.
It's a short-term stimulus. I mean, we spent about $120 billion this year. What has been the result? Why spend another $250 billion?
Assuming we can't get a long-term stimulus, meaning a long-term reform, which everybody agrees we need, but we can't do that between now and the election, is there something else that needs to happen?
Let's look at the macro picture. Okay, rather than doing these little tweaks, like Operation Twist or $250 billion stimulus that won't work, let's look at the fact that, our total debt is $14.7 trillion. You need to relate that to something. I mean, the problem with that is because our economy is $100 trillion large. It's $14.7 trillion large. And you have to understand that, just as a family, when their debt is too high, what's their economy going to look like? They're not going to be able to grow.
I'm not going to debate any of that with you because I agree with you.
You have to get a credible plan of spending restraint in place.
Assuming that you believe you can't find a credible plan between now and the elections, you agree with that. It's going to be very hard to get a credible plan that everyone agrees on between now and the elections. The question is there something else that has to happen in the short term? And if the answer is no, the answer is no.
I think we need to do, and this is what I hope the presidential election is about, is describe the problem to American people. Talk about regulations, talk about the size of our debt, talk about the fact that it's the debt in relationship to the size of our economy that is creating such a high level of uncertainty, and start running on a mandate type of election. Talk about the fact that it really is the entitlements, the drivers of an unsustainable level of government spending, and we have to reform those things and not be afraid of the issues.
Ron Johnson, thank you for being here. It's been a tremendous hour. We've had a great show. This was actually a lot of fun.
We did.